you try to build a snowman, it won't go so good. There ain't no snow on Sunset Boulevard.
Kingsmen was the finger-snapping vocal harmony group at Columbia College. At Columbia University, it was pretty much the same model as the Yale Whiffin' Poofs. And then it evolved or devolved or whatever you want to say. Blossomed, that's it. It blossomed into Sha Na Na.
Well, let me say, these guys were so square. Yes. You know, they had white turtlenecks, blue blazers. They would sing, you know, like Christmas carols. Hey, there's a little jump there. At the local hospitals and the school fight songs. Roar, lions, roar from the echo of the Hudson Valley. But then they added, they very smartly added some rock and rollers. That's where I came in.
We did a number of 50s doo-wop songs in that era, and they always were the biggest audience pleaser in many ways. And the older brother of one of our, I think he was the official president of the Kingsmen that year, his older brother there in graduate school came to rehearsal all ecstatic because we'd done this performance in which we included a number of...
Little Darling.
Yeah, we included a number of doo-wop songs.
I was there.
And we did other stuff too. And he goes into this rhapsody about how the rock culture was getting too self-scrutinizing and all uptight, introspective. And the 50s, the whole idea of celebrating the primal rock and roll was really appealing in the context of the pendulum had swung too far. Pendulum had swung so far that was now ready for us to represent and recapture the essence of rock and roll.
And that's the short answer. This guy was really a greaser.
Yes.
You know, from Long Island, kid's older brother.
Big
so,
time.
And at the time, our hair was so big, it would take like tubes of bro cream to get it looking like that. But the germ of the idea was these guys singing In the Still of the Night, A Little Darling, you know, Silhouettes, those harmony songs. And then it wasn't on the radio big. There was some, like on CBS, there was Oldies Night, but not a lot. So we really were the first neoclassicists of rock and roll. We went downtown, got leathers, you know, we got the t-shirts, the cutoffs. We rented the Golda Meir suits from the theatrical costume that were in Bye Bye Birdie. Eventually, we started making them. Now nobody wants to wear them, but they were a big signature at the beginning of that Golda Meir. So Golda Meir leather, creased up here, DAs, pompadours. That was the thing. It was theatrical, too.
Yeah.
We were one of the first acts to do theatrical rock. I mean, eventually, you know, we used to tell them, you know, they said gelatin on the wall at the Fillmore's. We say, we want lights on us. We're more of a Broadway tradition. And then the 70s became a theatrical rock time. You know, you get Queen, you had...
Alice Cooper.
Cooper, yes. Yeah. Elton John. You know, these acts came in with production for the first time. And, you know, we once did a bill, which was very interesting, of Alice Cooper and Sha Na Na. Now, you'd think that's two ends of the musical spectrum, yes. But theatrically, it was really interesting.
Just your performances were so electric.
We would just do song, 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 leave the audience breathless, nobody speak. We made one exception that became the, in my estimation, the genesis of the television show portraying Bowser as the leader of the group. He was the one guy who spoke during the live concert.
The actual originally bass singer who sang at Woodstock, Alan Cooper, was really the guy who created a brilliant role as the bass singer.
Right.
And I remember once we were in Boston and this kid was... in an altered state. And he jumped on the stage. Coop said, "Get off the stage, you hippie." Bam, greased and ready to rock and roll. We were song, song, song. We'd choreograph going in between songs to make sure we had a tight, fast...
Come to think of it,
the next song.
We would rehearse mic moves, transitions between songs, because what you just said was a big deal.
You mentioned Woodstock. Can you tell us a little bit about that? You were second to last before Jimi Hendrix.
We got $350 to do the show. That
we
check
did?
Bounced.
Yeah, we did. We
check
did.
Bounced, and we got a dollar to be in the movie. I don't even know if we ever got that dollar.
But it's
not
a
even sure we ever.
Legendary dollar.
If not, it was the greatest 10 cents or 8 cents I ever made, you know, because we're a completely unknown group. We were actually one of the last groups added because we weren't on the poster. We're posted for the movie, not for the thing. We got booked, and Steve Paul Scene in Hell's Kitchen, there was a club that Steve Paul scene, and it was the hangout. The Doors would hang out there, Hendrix, Joplin, and we were the last act to play there. We played there for Al, the bass player I'm talking about, the originator, Alan Cooper, went down and got this gig. Lines around the block, Hendrix came down, Joplin came down. I remember talking to some of the Led Zeppelin. I mean, we were causing a buzz because they had never seen
this. Yes. This was word of mouth right out of a Hollywood movie.
The last night, when a local protection, the boys were leaning on the club and they didn't want to pay anymore, there was a rumble sort of thing going on, and we didn't know what was going on.
I thought it was a nice thing because we get to be on stage with, I don't know, Blood, Sweat, and Tears or somebody I'd heard. I didn't have a clue how significant the Woodstock Rock Festival would turn out to be. Probably nobody did. But
Michael Lang and Artie Cornfield.
Yes, good job.
They were the two. They had gone up to our manager at the time, Ed Goodgold, and he said, these two guys, and he came to me, these guys want you to do Woodstock. And I'd been hearing about it. Then it was FM radio.
Right.
That was our social network.
At Woodstock, did you guys have like a favorite, you know, performer other than yourself that you were talking to, getting to know?
Dude, we were in survival mode.
Yeah.
There was no backstage. That was an emergency area to talk people down on bad trips. You were on your own. I think we slept in the van, maybe. Yes. I went up the top of the hill. I remember Creedence did a kick-ass set. But the rest of the time, it was like, I'm sort of a claustrophobe, but I decided I wanted to be alone at Woodstock and forget about it. There's a 500,000 people. You know, Woodstock was sort of the best of times and the worst of times. They said, get up there and do your 40 minutes. There's actually footage now of Hendrix on the side of the stage watching us do our thing. And luckily, from that, they captured at the hop and left it in the movie. The movie was running extremely long, but they left us in. It comes in a movie, you don't know what's the end of the concert. It looks like it's Saturday sometime. From now on, it's a free concert, man. Young editor on that film, and he was there for the whole week, and was Martin Scorsese.
He's going to put us in his next movie.
So I call him Marty now.
We're talking about the TV show.
97 half hours. Dude. Procter & Gamble wanted to sponsor a show, and they wanted the syndicated sort of monkeys-like
half hour.
They went to Chicago, who didn't want to do it, didn't have actors and everything. They went to the Beach Boys, who, you know, weren't communicating too well with each other. So we were like third or fourth on their list. And fortunately, we had the musicians, the singers, and the actors all self-contained. And four or five of us did have chops.
Borah High School in Boise, Idaho. I was the lead in The Rainmaker, the musical production.
Forget that. He was Kanicki in Greece. I'm not impressed. He was Kanicki. Give it up. Come on.
Anyway,
we made a pilot, it tested well, and then we were off and running, and it was an amazing show. We shot fast, we'd rehearse one day and choreograph, and it was mad. And the next day, we'd do a show and a half tape a day, but it was cool. It was, and it ran well, and then it sort of got knocked out of the box by Entertainment Tonight kind of shows. They all came on big, and then out of there. And Patricia Birch and Randall Kleiser were looking
the choreographer and the director.
They wanted to augment the songs from the play with classic old real hits, you know? So that's where they came to our TV show, watched it, and they all thought it was great. It was like done like that. And then we spent the week shooting at the hop scene, the big hop scene they had. So we sang, we did sing one from the Magic Changes, but then we did Hound Dog, Tears on My Pillow, Rock and Roll is Here to Stay, Blue Moon. So we bought the titles of the original titles from the 50s, late 50s, into the collection for the film. And then they also added, Olivia Newton-John added some originals, and that last minute they said they need a song for Travolta. And Scott was hanging out with
Louis St. Louis,
and they co-wrote Sandy, which they needed for the drive-in scene, in about a day, and it was recorded 2 days later, and then they were filming against it. Stranded at the drive-in, so streamers, we do that in our show every night.
It was really ostensibly just the movie version of the Broadway musical. The Broadway musical of Grease was a big hit, and I would submit because of the whole 50s obsession. It probably wouldn't have happened if Sean and I hadn't been there earlier with our success, or even Happy Days.
They actually came to us when we were developing that off-Broadway, but we were sort of kicking off and doing on touring and everything. They said, do you want to get involved with, we have a little workshop, you know? And so we said, no, we're actually got him, you know, making good dough, or on concert tour. And,
yeah,
but thank
sounded,
you. So what sounded, goes around comes around, you know, whatever. It was 7-8 years later, we're in the movie.
Travolta was a sweet man hanging out when we had to hurry up and wait at Huntsville High School, whatever, Huntington Park High School, the original location of the dance, of the prom scene in the movie. Hurry Up and Wait with John Travolta was very
pleasant. Yeah, he was fun. He'd come over and we'd doodle at the piano and we'd sing some doo-wop.
He was a very gentlemanly guy. He'd just gotten finished with Saturday Night Fever, which is one of my all-time favorite movies.
Huge.
So if John Travolta ever wants us in his next movie, that's an option.
Okay.
So along
hey,
with,
thank you.
Along with,
thank you.
ShaNaNa.com.
What? Actually, what it is, we've collected songs that we have done and released over the years. There were 15 of them. 15 of them, and then we have 6 brand new ones that are destined to be classics, we hope.
Which makes this an utter bargain.
Donnie wrote
bargain.
One called Say Ho Ho Ho.
Yes.
And I do a little cameo at the end as Santa Claus, which I'm very proud of. But
ho, ho, ho.
I have one called I Saw Mama Twisting with Santa Claus. Santa's on a Diet. There's some fun songs in there, and they go from a Chuck Berry style song to a Stone doo-wop song to more like a, your thing is almost like a Four Freshmen tight harmony, middle of the road kind of thing that they used to do in the 50s, and yeah, we got a little bit of everything in there. And
I was thinking Mitch Miller actually, but nobody knows who that is.
Yeah, some people.
Some
do.
People know who that is.
But he knows.
Sing along with Mitch. Anyway.
Yeah.
More research later.
And then anyway, it was a lot of fun to do, and you got to check it out. You know, did I show it to you?
It's at
21 tracks.
ShaNaNa.com, Amazon, Allegro.
Amazon.
I don't know, man. You know.
Look it up on Amazon.com. What's that title again? What's the name?
It's
of that?
You got to search around. iTunes is one thing. And then over at Amazon, it's another thing. But yeah,
but the album has a name.
Yeah, it's
Rockin' Christmas.
It's Rockin' Christmas, but it's the classic collection, not to be confused with other things.
Show me, go, hey.
The songs on there will take their place alongside White Christmas, and our grandchildren will never have to work.
There's one called I Got the Blues for Christmas.
Hurry. Did you write that?
Yes, I did.
What a coincidence.
I produced it.
What'd you say the title is again?
Well, there ain't no holly in Hollywood. If you're trying to build a snowman, it won't go.